Hello everyone, I welcome you all and I have a small request. You can see a link I have sent in my chat box. I request all of you to click on that particular link and share your location. It's like a small survey. Okay, yes. So please click on that particular link and share your location. And I also request you, you know, you can post some of your questions related to metallurgy before the session so that I can take your questions in my session, you know. Which link, Dr. Ajay, there is a link mentioned, just a minute. I'm going to share it again. This link. That's polev.com. So please click on the link and share your location. Also, I request you to share your questions related to metallurgy, your doubts related to metallurgy, so that I can take all those doubts and you know, I can explain you in a better way in my session. We are going to start in another 5 minutes. Link is not visible. The link is there in the chat box. It's polev.com/niharikajain660. Is it visible now? No? Just a minute. No, not visible. It's there on my Facebook page. Can you please go to my timeline and I have shared a Facebook live video there. So the link is visible. Please click on that link and share your current location. Okay, so now we're going to start with the presentation. I see the people have started coming. Okay, so shall we start now? All right. Okay, so now I'm going to start my session. And as you all know, you know me well. I suppose I'm Dr. Niharika and I'm an endodontist. I'm also a professor in the Department of Conservative Dentistry and Endodontics in Bilaspur Dental College, Triveni Dental College. And I am a research collaborator. So I am a kind of research loving person. I am into research. And I am quite interested in biomechanics of rotary endodontics. So I started a series known as Biomechanics of Rotary Endodontics, where I have already discussed and I'm discussing I'm going to discuss the basic principles of endodontic files, especially the rotary files. By rotary, I mean the motor driven files. That means the rotary and the reciprocating files both. Okay. And so today's session is going to be about understanding the metallurgy of rotary file. You know, friends, this topic is really, really interesting because there are so many files, rotary files these days. In fact, the market is full of rotary files. And as a dental practitioner, we don't know which file to buy, whether we should use a file with a M wire technology or C wire or T wire or CM wire. What are these files? And what are the nitrile files and how they work, you know, and how they are better with your stainless steel file? Because my principle is, once we understand the basic principle of metallurgy, how the files are made, how they are modified, we can use the rotary files as per our choice. That means we can use the file according to the anatomical characteristic of the root canal in which we are going to work. It's going to be case selective. It's going to be operator selective. That means the files with which I am comfortable, with the files which I don't break easily. So in today's session, I'm going to discuss all about metallurgy of the rotary files. The topic is really vast. It has a lot of physics and chemistry in this. So I request you all to be a little patient and use your brains today. Okay, it's just not like listening. You have to interpret each and every chemical reaction and equation with the other one. Okay, so today's session is also going to be on Facebook Live as requested by a lot of persons. Okay, so starting with the session, as we all know that shaping instruments have changed with time. Earlier, we used to use the stainless steel files, but studies have reported that stainless steel file reports or result in high procedural errors. All right, they create zipping, they create a lot of ledging, and they are difficult when you're doing a case of curved canals because they are quite stiff in nature. And because of this, their success rate is also very less. So to overcome the drawbacks of stainless steel endophiles, nickel titanium files were introduced in endodontics. Studies have reported that the use of nitrile files results in around 19% less procedural errors and 77% more chances of post-operative healing. Okay. So what are the advantages? Why do we use a nickel titanium file? Because it maintains the canal shape. It takes the shape of the canal in which it is put. It has a high cutting efficiency. It is quite super elastic. You know, you take a file, you bend it, you move it, and when you release the load, the file comes back to its normal shape. So it behaves like a spring. And it has a greater flexibility. Now, flexibility is a characteristic which basically depends upon the design of the file. It depends upon the cross-section, the tip, the diameter of the file. But yes, it also depends upon the metallurgical characteristic of the file, like the material from which the file is made. But despite of these best advantages, what is the biggest drawback we all face with rotary nickel titanium file is instrument separation. Okay. So when we separate a file, this is the biggest nightmare for every clinician. And when we talk to the local dealers who are present around us, they tell us, ma'am, this file is not good. You should discard this file. You should buy this file because this file is made up of blah, blah, blah metallurgy. This file is made up of blah, blah, blah technology. So it gives a better result. All right. So to understand that technology, to understand that procedure, we have to understand the simple mechanical properties of the file. So rotary nickel titanium files have a really, really high risk of separation inside the canal because they don't give a sign. They just separate. So today I'm going to teach about metallurgy of the rotary files. Now, these rotary files are made up of nickel titanium alloy, nitinol alloy. Okay, the nitinol alloy has nickel and titanium. As we all know, alloy is made up of two or more elements. So, nickel titanium alloy is made up of nickel metal and titanium metal. How much nickel is present? 56% by weight of the alloy is made up of nickel, and 44% by weight of the alloy is made up of titanium. The best thing about nitinol alloy is shape memory and super elasticity. Shape memory means you take a file, you press it, you release the load, the file comes back to its original shape. So the file has a tendency to come back to its original shape. That is known as a shape memory alloy. Now, superelastic property means the file behaves like a spring. You apply load on the file will take up that load to a particular limit. That principle is known as superelasticity. And science says that near equiatomic nickel titanium alloys, they have these properties of shape memory and pseudoelasticity. Now, what are equiatomic alloys? Any alloy which has components in equal weight are known as equiatomic alloy. So, nickel titanium has components of equal weight in relation to the weight of the elements. So, why do these elements have shape memory and pseudoelasticity? Because nickel titanium alloy has a characteristic thermoelastic phase transformation. That means they have two or three phases. Okay, there is one phase, you heat it, you will get a second phase, and you will get a third phase. For example, water. Water exists in the form of ice, water vapor, and normal water. Okay, in the same manner, nickel titanium alloy exists as a solid mass known as austenite phase. It exists as a slightly deformed phase known as martensite phase or twinned martensite phase. Then it exists in a completely deformed manner, which is known as detwinned or deformed martensite phase. So studies have shown that even a slight change in the composition can alter the transformation temperature by 10 degrees. Now, what is this transformation temperature? Transformation temperature is the temperature from which one phase of the alloy, changes to other phase. Okay, so even a slight change in composition can result a drastic change in transformation temperature. Let's see this diagram. Just a minute. Okay, so as I mentioned, basically the nitinol alloy has two phases. Okay, just as a beginner, remember it has two phases. One phase is known as austenite phase, and the other one is known as martensite phase. The file is stiff. It has a good cutting efficiency in austenite phase, but the file is flexible in martensite phase. Now, austenite phase is chemically marked as B2 phase. And martensite phase is chemically known as B19 phase. So what happens when your file is in austenite phase and when the wire is cooled? Okay, the phase changes to martensite phase. Molecules move and it comes to martensite phase. Now when the martensite phase is heated again, it moves back to your austenite phase. All right. This is the basic characteristic of a nitinol alloy. This is why the nitinol alloys have shape memory. That means when a nitinol wire is heated, okay, it regains its austenite form. It comes back to its austenite form. But when the deformed nitinol wire is subjected to cooling, it does not go back to its original form. All right. So austenite phase and martensite phase has two temperatures, AS and AF. AS is the temperature at which austenite phase forms, and AF is the temperature at which austenite phase ends. Okay. Suppose I say AS is around 100 degrees centigrade and AF is around 140 degrees centigrade. That means at 100 degrees centigrade, the nitrile wire will start changing to its austenite form, and at 140 degrees centigrade, you have austenite phase of nitrile wire. Okay. Below austenite finish phase, when you cool, that means you come down to 90 degrees or 80 degrees, you are running into martensite phase. Martensite phase, in martensite phase also, as I mentioned, you have a starting phase, which is known as MS, and MF, which is the temperature of the martensite finish phase. Okay. So, when the wire is in original position or nitrile file is in original position, that is your A phase or austenite phase. When it is in a deformed position, that is your martensite phase. Okay. Now, austenite phase has a high modulus of elasticity and martensite phase has a low modulus of elasticity. Let me tell you what are these. Okay. Modulus of elasticity means stress upon strain. Okay. So modulus of elasticity is directly proportional to stress and indirectly proportional to strain. That means, let's say 1 Newton force causes a change of 1 millimeter in a wire or in a nitrile file. So your modulus of elasticity will be 1 Newton force, which is the strain, divided by 1 millimeter. Okay, that is your modulus of elasticity. So modulus of elasticity directly depends upon the stress applied and indirectly depend upon the strain or the change or elongation. Now going back, modulus of elasticity of austenite phase is very high. When it is high, elongation is less because this is a stiff phase. In contrast, modulus of elasticity for martensitic phases are really less. That means with a small stress, it causes more elongation. Okay. So martensite is your deformed phase and austenite is your original position or original phase. Now, most of the time we come across through these terms, twin martensite and detwin martensite. What are these? You have a file in austenite phase. This is known as B2 phase or body-centered cubic arrangement of lattice. You can see in the diagram. When load is applied or when wire in the austenite phase or file in the austenite phase is cooled below the austenite finish temperature, it comes to your twinned martensite phase. Twinned martensite phase means there is no visible deformation of the crystal. There is no visible deformation of the file. Within the file, you can see deformed arrangement of the lattice, but overall, there is no deformation. All right. If you continue to apply more and more stress on the file, the twinned martensite will change into detwinned martensite. That means there is a visible deformation of the file. Okay. So that is your deformed or detwinned martensite. So original transformation path at transformation temperature range is from austenite, which is marked as B2, to martensite, which is marked as B99. But after special thermomechanical treatment, there is an intermittent phase is formed, which is known as rhombohedral or R phase. This is the phase. You have a austenite phase, you have a martensite phase. In between, a intermittent phase is formed, okay? This phase is known as rhombohedral phase. Now, when studies were done, the authors reported that R phase and M phase are almost equal in comparison with superelasticity, with shape memory and cyclic fatigue. Friends, I would tell you that nickel titanium files fracture mainly because of two reasons. One is cyclic fatigue and one is torsional fatigue. Cyclic fatigue means the fire is moving at, the fire is taking 100 cycles in 1 minute. Okay, and after 100 cycle, if you use the fire for another 50 cycle, the fire will break. That means you are working with the life of the fire. Suppose the life of the fire ends at 100 cycle, but if you're going to use the fire for 150 cycles or for many canals, the fire will break. That is why the manufacturers recommend that this particular fire will work only in 5 cases or 6 molars or 7 molars, because that is the cyclic fatigue of the fire. All right, if you are going to use a pro taper and you use it in 20th molar, you are absolutely going to fracture the fire, because the cyclic fatigue has already been crossed, right? Now there is a principle known as torsional fatigue. Torsional fatigue means you take a new fire, you put it inside the canal, the fire binds somewhere, and finally the fire fractures. There are torsional forces or high torque forces. I explained these things in my previous lecture. The recorded version of the lecture is there on Facebook. It's also there on my YouTube channel. So if any one of you have missed it, you can go through that lecture to clear your principles and doubts on torque and forces inside the root canal. So coming back to these principles, you have a cyclic fatigue, you have a torsional fatigue. Now, when you have R phase and M phase, in R phase and M phase, the cyclic fatigue is high. Why? Because these phases are very flexible. The atoms move, the molecules move. They can absorb the stresses. They absorb the stresses and the shape of the fire is distorted. It acts like a spring. That is why the fire in a M phase, martensite phase or R phase has high cyclic fatigue. It doesn't fracture easily. Whereas a fire in an austenite phase has low cyclic fatigue. It breaks easily. Okay. Let's see, for example, you have a slime. I'm sure you must have all seen a slime layer or a rubber band. Okay. How is a rubber band? You stretch, stretch, stretch. The rubber band will stretch as much as you can and finally it breaks. Okay. So nitrile fire in martensite and R phase behaves like a rubber band. Okay. Whereas the fire in a austenite phase behaves like a stone. It is very hard. And when you apply force there, the stone is not going to elongate. It's going to fracture. Right? So I shared the same thing with you. Modulus of elasticity. Now, how is a nitrile file made? You take a raw nitrile wire. You can subject the raw nitrile wire to special heat treatment, or you directly subject the raw nitrile wire to machining. Okay. By machining, you can incorporate those grooves, flutes, taper, cross-section changes, radial ends. All those procedures are done by machining. After machining, the surface is very rough, so it requires a special surface treatment to reduce the chances of crack initiation and crack propagation. And then the file is subjected to final heat treatment. All right. This is a very, very basic thing how a rotary file is made. So there are two principles by which you can modify the alloy, by which you can modify the properties of the file. One, you are acting on the surface of the file. That means alteration in the surface of the alloy only. And secondly, you are acting throughout the file. That means heat treatment of the file. Okay? So let's go on the principles by which you can modify the surface anatomy of the nitinol alloy. One principle is plasma immersion ion implantation. The principle was invented in the year 1980s by Conrad and Tendis. The principle is very simple. It appears very difficult when you see it, but it's absolutely simple. Okay. You have a vacuum chamber. Inside the vacuum chamber, the file is placed. This file is connected to a negative electrode, which is known as cathode. All right. So when electric current is passed, it activates the file. The file takes up electrons. Okay, the file already has electrons because it is connected to the cathode. Now, this electric current activates the plasma which is present inside the vacuum chamber. Now imagine file is completely surrounded by negative ions or electrons. So what is going to happen? File is going to attract all the positive ions from the surrounding plasma. So the plasma positive ions will bombard the surface of the file. That principle is known as plasma immersion ion implantation. So your specimen is placed in a vacuum chamber, which is surrounded by a cathode sheet, and the specimen is placed inside the plasma or immersed inside the plasma. When it is activated by a high voltage supply, the specimen or the rotary file or the nitride wire becomes negatively charged. When it becomes negatively charged, it attracts the positive ions from the plasma. Because of high voltage, these positive ions are accelerated, and once and when something is accelerated, it just bombards the surface of the specimen. You imagine you see Formula One races, you see a lot of Ferraris moving, okay, at a huge speed, and when something comes in between, they just bombard. So this is the principle of plasma ion immersion implantation. Studies were done and they evaluated that argon, boron and nitrogen can be used to bombard the surface of nickel titanium. But out of these, nitrogen was really capable. Why? Because nitrogen ion implantation improved the cyclic fatigue resistance of nitride rotary file. How? See, nitride rotary file, after machining, the surface has irregularities. Okay? If the surface is quite rough. So what is going to happen when you are going to use that rough rotary file inside the canal? The high peaks may act as peaks of residual stresses. The stresses will harbor, will live, or will be there on the huge peaks of the rough surfaces of the file, and they can cause crack initiation and propagation or fracture of the file. So plasma ion implantation removes those defects by this mechanism. All right? And it enhances the cyclic fatigue resistance of the file. What are the advantages? Studies have shown that it has a high cutting efficiency. It has an improved wear resistance. That means it has a better cyclic fatigue. That means the same file can be used in multiple canals in a larger number of cases. For example, a pro taper file or a two-shaped file, when used in 20 or 30 canals, it breaks. But if a file is treated by this particular treatment, the same file can be used in multiple cases. All right. In short, it enhances the cutting life of the cutting efficiency of the file and the longevity of the file. Next principle is coating the surface of nitride with oxygen. The principle is very simple. You have nickel and you have titanium in a rotary file. So when the rotary file is exposed to oxygen, basically in a closed chamber, you are giving oxygen there, or the closed chamber with oxygen ions or atmospheric oxygen, the oxygen combines with titanium more because it has a more affinity towards titanium. When this oxygen combines with titanium, it forms titanium oxides, okay? And these titanium oxides prevent the surface of the file from corrosion. So it also enhances the cutting efficiency of the file. It prevents corrosion of the rotary file when in contact with sodium hypochlorite. Okay. Why? What happens when you're doing rotary endodontics? Sometimes your canal is filled with irrigant. Or when there is a curved canal, you use EDTAs, you use hypochlorite. So when there is hypochlorite inside the canal, you put a nickel titanium rotary file inside the canal, the sodium hypochlorite may cause corrosion of nickel titanium files. All right. And it can also compromise the cutting efficiency of the file. So if the file is heat treated or if the file is surface treated by these methodologies, creating titanium oxide layer on the file, the chances of corrosion caused by sodium hypochlorites are comparatively less. So, and yes, this file has high fatigue resistance also. That means this technology is quite capable in enhancing the life of the file, because the amount of stresses accumulated on the file during shaping procedures are quite less. Next topic or next principle is thermal nitridation. Nitridation means you are bombarding the surface with nitrogen to get nitrides. All right. The most common method is powder immersion reaction assisted coating, and it produces titanium nitrides on the surface of the nickel titanium file. Let's see how. You have a closed chamber, and within this vacuum chamber, you have placed a nitride wire. Okay. So, you have placed a nitride wire. Okay, the nitrogen ions will come and form a layer on the surface of nickel titanium wire, but atmospheric oxygen cannot come and combine with it. Okay, so the final product is titanium nitrides forming on the surface of nickel titanium wire. So this is formed at around 250 degrees centigrade, and nitrogen ions diffuse into the sample. So the new surface of the file consists of an outer layer of nickel titanium nitrides and a thicker layer of other element or other chemical titanium nitride variation underneath. The advantages are it increases the cutting efficiency, also the corrosion resistance when the file comes in contact with sodium hypochlorite. Next is cryogenic treatment of the root canal file. Cryo comes from a word which means very cold, and genic means to produce. So this is a method by which a cold temperature is used to produce desired morphological changes in the file. There are three phases of cryogenic treatment to which a root canal file is exposed. First, the file is cooled to a very, very less temperature below 0 degree, which is around 185 minus degree centigrade. Okay. Then the file is holded at that particular temperature for 24 hours. Why? Because during that particular temperature, all the austenite phases or all the austenite form of the file is converted to martensite form. Next phase is, after holding the file for 24 hours at minus 85 degrees centigrade, you are gradually heating the file back to the ambient temperature. So now let's see what is happening. This is the setup. Okay, you have a cryo box, and in the cryo box, you place the root canal file. You apply liquid nitrogen, you can apply liquid nitrogen, but gaseous nitrogen is preferred. Okay, so there are two types of cryogenic treatment. There is a hollow and deep. Hollow means the root canal file is subjected to a temperature of 50 to 100 degrees centigrade in the minus range. Deep means the root canal is subjected to a further low temperature of, you know, -180 or -190 degrees centigrade. In endodontics, we are using deep cryogenic treatment. So to understand cryogenic treatment, let's go and understand what is entropy. Entropy in very simple terms means state of disorder. You can see in the first diagram, this crystal lattice has lower entropy, but a glass filled with a fluid or a liquid will have greater entropy. Okay, so a crystal lattice has lower, but the fluid have greater entropy or greater disorder. All right. And third law of thermodynamics states that at a temperature of absolutely zero kelvins, 0 degrees Celsius, a perfectly crystalline solid has zero entropy. That means there is absolutely no disorder within the solid at 0 degrees centigrade. So what happens? When you subject the wire to a temperature of zero or rest, all the stresses are relieved. The wire is in a state of zero entropy, minimum entropy. There is no disorder. Okay. And when there is no disorder, all the stresses will move from the wire to outside. So what is going to happen when the stresses move out? It's going to close the defects. Okay. And how is a defect created? When the file gets stuck. Imagine torsional fracture or torsional fatigue. When a file is moving, the tip of the file is blocked in a canal, maybe near the curvature of the canal. So that file has some demarcations, will get some demarcations or some distortion on the surface. Minor cracks may also occur on the surface. When the wire is in a state of minimum entropy or minimum disorderness, okay, the stresses will move out from the wire, closing those particular defects. The interatomic size will reduce. The defects will minimize as the stresses will move out. So all the austenite phase also converts to martensite phase and carbide ion precipitates. All these factors increases the toughness of the wire and resistance of the wire. So advantages are higher micro hardness. The file is hard. It has a high cutting efficiency. It has improved cyclic fatigue. Okay. So somehow if you get a chance to work with files which are surface treated with cryogenic treatment, they are really good. Next important principle, electropolishing. Electropolishing is an electrochemical surface treatment. I'm sure you must have all heard that a lot of people coming to you and selling the files saying these files are electropolished. So let's see what is electropolishing. Electropolishing is also known as electrochemical polishing or electrolytic polishing or reverse plating. These are same principles, okay? Different names of the same principle. So a basic electrochemical reaction involves removal of a material from a metallic workpiece in case root canal file, thereby reducing the surface roughness by leveling the micro peaks and valleys and improving the surface finish. Let's see how. This was first introduced by FKG in the year 1999. Let's see the principle of electropolishing. So you have a bath or tub in which there is electrolyte. You have an electrode which is negatively attached or attached to a negative part of the cell. This is known as cathode. Other electrode which is attached to the positive side is known as anode. So at the anode or at this particular electrode, we attach a root canal file. Okay, that means machined root canal file. We attach that file here. Now what happens when electric current is passed? This part or this file is positively charged. So it releases electrons. It releases the metallic ions from here. Okay. And when metallic ions are released, this is how the morphology changes. Rough peaks and valleys changes to smooth finish. Okay. So electropolishing of niti file means there is surface oxidation. That means electrons are lost in the form of dissolution of metal ions. Surfaces are also covered with titanium oxides metal. Okay. There is elimination of surface defect and surface fracturing. So what is happening? The surface becomes smooth by removal of the metal ions. At the same time, titanium is combining with oxygen and forming titanium oxide. This titanium oxide is preventing corrosion of the surface of root canal file when it comes in contact with some aggressive chemical agent like sodium hypochlorite. You can look here. This is a photograph by 3D profilometer picture. And this is of profile which is non-electropolished. Okay. And look at this. This is after electropolishing. So the surfaces are absolutely smooth. Okay. When surfaces are smooth, there are no peaks and valleys. You can see here minor irregularities. So these irregularities can harbor stresses. They can concentrate stresses and cause fracture initiation and crack propagation, or crack initiation and crack propagation. That is why electropolished files are anytime better than non-electropolished file. Whenever you are purchasing a rotary file, please go for electropolished file. Look at this diagram of rays. This is an after picture of electropolishing. Look at this surface. How smooth is the surface? Okay, this is after electropolishing. So advantages are, it enhances the cutting efficiency. It reduces surface defects. Okay, it increases the fracture resistance. The longevity of the file, simple. It increases the resistance to corrosion because during electropolishing, titanium oxides are formed on the surface. There are various systems which are electropolished, easily available. You have two shape files, one shape, rays, endo sequence. I'm a big fan of two shape files. So these files you can buy and you can use, but it's always better to use an electropolished file. Now, those were the procedure used to modify the surface of the file. Now we are going to play with the complete file itself. So we are going to do heat treatment. We are going to learn about heat treatment of the files. Heat treatment of the file is really, really important. Why? Because of heat treatment, the crystal lattice of the file changes. There is transformation of austenite phase to R phase to martensite phase, or vice versa. When there is complete phase transformation, there is also change in the cyclic fatigue of the file. Okay. There is increase in the flexibility of the file. As I mentioned, martensite files are really flexible. They are more ductile. Austenite files are stiff. When you want to think about austenite and martensite phase, please remember austenite is like a stone and martensite is like a rubber band. So they can also affect the torsional resistance of the file. And yes, the heat treatment also plays an important role in the micro hardness of the file. Let's go with different heat treatment. So you have heat treatment of the file, which is done during the machining procedure. That means you take a nitrile wire, subject it to heat treatment, then you do machining, produce grooves, flutes, spirals, cross sections. After machining, you expose them to surface modifications like electropolishing. And after surface modifications, you may expose to second round of heat treatment again. So in cases like M wire, R phase nitrile wire, and CM wire, there are modifications done before machining. And in cases with gold files, blue files, or EDM high flex files, surface heat treatment is done after surface modifications. Before, after surface modifications, yes. So let's go with M wire technology. Now, this technology was earlier initiated or earlier developed in the year 2007, and this is patented by Dentsply. Remember, I told you something in the second or third slide, that if there is any slight modification in the composition of nitinol, the phase transformation temperature changes. So this is how we are going to change the phase transformation temperature. We are going to alter the composition of the nitinol alloy. When we talk about M wire, we have slightly altered the composition. The manufacturers have slightly altered the composition. The initial nitinol alloy, or the basic nitinol alloy, contains 56% by weight of nickel. But with M wire, the manufacturers take a nitinol alloy which has 55.8% by weight of nickel and 44.2% by weight of titanium with very less amount of trace elements. Okay, so coming back to this slide again, you have A phase, austenite phase, you have M phase. Okay, A phase is in between austenite start and finish temperature, and M phase is also in between martensite start and martensite finish temperature. The same thing, modulus of elasticity. Please keep this diagram in mind. Modulus of elasticity is directly proportional to the stress and inversely proportional to the strain. So how does M wire has different metallurgical characteristic? Let's see. So what the manufacturers did, they slightly changed the composition of the alloy. When they changed the composition of the alloy, the austenite finish temperature changes. This is in the range of 43 to 50 degrees centigrade. Okay. Now imagine you have a file in austenite temperature or austenite phase. When you heat it, the file enters the martensitic phase. Okay. Sorry, when you cool it, the file enters the martensitic phase. That means if you are cooling at a temperature of less than 43 degrees centigrade, you are coming back to a martensitic phase. Imagine somewhere around 37 degrees centigrade, which is the temperature of your oral cavity or the intracanal temperature. At 37 degrees centigrade, the wire has a mixed composition of austenite, martensite, and R phases. Okay? Because when you heat up, when you cool a wire which is in austenite phase, you forms a martensite phase. So somewhere at around 37 degrees centigrade, the wire has more martensite, some R phase, and some austenite phase. Because martensite phase is incorporated in the wire, so the wire produces more deformation. The wire is more ductile. Okay. Therefore, the principle says that M wire is super elastic when placed inside the canal, or the M wire is highly flexible. Okay. So the advantages are the wire is very flexible. The M wire files are very flexible. They have increased cyclic fatigue during clinical condition. Why? Because during clinical condition, a file which is made up of M wire has martensite phase, has R phase, and some amount of austenite phase. It also increases the torsional resistance because the file has martensite phase, R phase, and austenite phase during clinical conditions when you put the file inside the canal. Okay? So, coming to, and what are the files which are commonly available with M wire technology? Wave 1 is the file. I'm not talking about Wave 1 Gold, Wave 1. Okay? So, coming back to R phase, the original transformation path is from austenite to martensite. Okay? But when you apply a special thermomechanical treatment, an intermittent phase is formed, which is known as R phase. Okay? The advantages of R phase is that it has high super elasticity, which is just like your martensitic phases. It has high shape memory alloy, which is just like your martensite phase, and it has cyclic fatigue also. So now the manufacturer said that why should we go to martensite phase? We can also play with R phase only, right? If you're getting something as good at martensite just before martensite phase, so let's play with that phase. This is how it works. A phase, austenite phase, you cool it, you get rhomboidal phase or R phase. You cool further, you get M phase. But we are not going further. We are doing modifications in the R phase only, because R phase has same properties as that of a M phase. So the manufacturers, they applied suitable holding temperature by which you get R phase at your desired clinical temperature range, which is 37 degrees centigrade. Okay. Once you get the R phase at 37 degrees centigrade, you get everything. You get a file which is super elastic in the canal. You get a file which is highly flexible in the canal. And you get a file which has high cyclic fatigue in the canal. So this procedure, or the R phase technology, was basically used and patented by Cybron Endo in the year 2008. The manufacturing procedure for making twisted file, it included first the R phase heat treated wires were used. Okay. They were twisted. they were not machined, they were not grounded, they were twisted. And after twisting, the wire, the file was subjected to special surface conditioning. That is how you get a twisted file. Okay. Other file systems with R-phase technology are K3 by Cybron Endo. R-phase is basically a patent of Cybron Endo. So most of the files by Cybron Endo are made up from R-phase technology only. Okay. So as I mentioned, the advantage is it has high superior resistance. It has high resistance to cyclic fatigue. That means the longevity of the file is more and it is quite flexible in nature. But they have lower torsional strength. That means the wire when or the file, if in case it gets stuck with the within the root canal walls, it separates. Okay, so it has a lower torsional strength than your conventional NiTi files. So if you are going to use it for straight canals, it works well. But if you are going to use it with curved canals, especially the instruments or files from R-phase, prepare a glide path properly. At least till 25 number K file or 20 number K file minimum, then you use a file which is made from R-phase technology. Okay. Okay. These are the files which are made from M-wire technology like Protaper Next, Wave 1, Reciproke. They all are made from M-wire technology. Okay. Now coming to CM-wire. This technology was introduced in the year 2010 by Coltine Welded, and the CM-wire is a patent by Coltine Welded. See, it's something like, there are so many file systems available in the world, and you have a lot of companies who are marketing root canal files in the world. So it's just like the manufacturers are playing with the transition temperature, with the phases. Some are working with martensite phase, getting M phase, M wire technology. Some are working with R phase, getting your Cybron EndoCard TF and K3 files. So it's just like manufacturers are playing with the different phases during metallurgical transformation of the file. Okay. So CM wire is another method by which you can achieve a better mechanical property of the file. Okay. It has a lower nickel content. So when there is any change in the composition, the phase transformation temperature changes. So this is a special thermomechanical treatment. In this, the file does not take its original shape even after unloading. That means you take a file, you bend the file, okay, and the file, as soon as you remove the stress, the file comes back to its original shape, right? That is your shape memory. But with CM wire, if you bend a file and you remove the stress, the file will remain in the bended position. So this principle is really nice when you're going to pre-bend a file and you're going to use that same pre-bended file, rotary nickel titanium file inside the canal. Okay? Original shape is restored only after heat application or autoclaving. Why? Because when the files are heated or autoclaved, they come back to their austenite. So this is your HyFlex file by Coltine. If you remove the stress, the file remains in the bended shape, in the same shape again. You can see this. This is, now let's see why. CM NiTi wires have high austenite finish temperature. The austenite finish temperature is around 47 to 55 degrees centigrade. Now imagine any temperature which is less than 40 degrees centigrade. At that temperature, your file will be in martensitic form. Clear? So when you put the file inside the canal, the file takes the temperature of the canal. The file takes the temperature of the canal. That means the file is at 37 degrees centigrade. So at 37 degrees centigrade, there will be a phase transformation from the original austenite to martensite phase. Now, there will be a mixed martensite phase rather. You will have R phase, some austenite phase, and a lot of martensitic phases at body temperature. When the file works in the martensitic phases, it has a better mechanical property. So let's see the advantage. It has increased resistance to cyclic fatigue. It has more flexibility because the file is in a martensite phase. It has an enhanced cutting efficiency. But the drawback is there is increased tendency of permanent plastic deformation. That means if you have bended the file, you put it inside the canal, you heat the file takes its original shape. And again, and when you take it, when you move it again and again, or when you're going to use the same file again and again, at one stage, the file will not bend. It will break. So these instruments are commonly recommended for single use only. If you are using HyFlex system by Coltine, please don't use the same system for multiple canals. Okay, limit the system for some canals only. Next. Coltine people or Coltine manufacturing company modified the technique. Okay. They said we have CM wire. Now we will do some surface modification on the CM wire nitride. So that surface modification is done by the principle of electrical discharge machining. Let's see how. Coltine welded introduced the system, and HyFlex EDM is the file which is made from electrical discharge machining technique. It is the first endodontic instrument. What is electrical discharge machining? Non-contact controlled metal removal process, which is used to remove precise metal ions only by means of inducing electrical spark erosion to achieve a finished part, is known as electrical discharge machining. So you have a tank. In the tank, you have a dielectric fluid. Okay, dielectric fluid is something like, it is a insulator. It does not have its own, it does not allow electricity to pass through it, but it has some electromagnetic effect. Just remember this. So in the tank, you have a dielectric fluid, and in the dielectric fluid, your rotary file is suspended, okay? And there is a moving electrode above your rotary file. So what will happen? The moving electrode is connected to the negative side of the battery. It will produce current, and this current, when comes in contact with the dielectric fluid, causes spark. And this spark removes the irregular surface from the workpiece or from the file, producing a smooth surface. This is how it works. This is your workpiece. This is a cross section of the file. This is your machining tool. This machining tool is negative, is a cathode. So when this is charged, it produces electrical spark. And this electrical sparks reduces or remove metallic ions from the surface of the file. These metallic ions move inside the dielectric fluid and they are dissipated, they are gone. Okay, so the machining tool is moved towards the workplace. Applied voltage is applied, which ionizes the dielectric fluid. The ionization of the dielectric fluid along with the machining tool, which is moving, produces electric spark. It removes the metallic ions, vaporizes them, and these metallic ions are dissolved in the dielectric fluid and resolidified and flushed away. Look at this diagram. This is a profilometer diagram. You can see, because of electrical discharging machining process, the files have a lot of irregularities on the surface. You can see peaks and valleys here. But what are the advantages? Even though the file has a lot of peaks and valleys, there are very, very minimal chance of mechanical stress generation and production during grinding procedure. And There is a less cyclic fatigue also. The files don't break easily. The files don't act as point of stress concentration. It increases the hardness of the file. And studies have shown that there is slight modification or very minimal modification in the surface of the file after root canal procedures. The surface doesn't get altered easily after root canal procedure. Because of this EDM process, it has high cutting efficiency and the file is also quite flexible. Why? Because in the clinical conditions, the file has M phase, it has R phase, and absolutely no austenite phase. You can see here, this is intact HyFlex file, which is made from CM wire, and this is a used HyFlex file. You can see there is changes in the morphology of the file, but this is when you compare HyFlex EDM file before using in the canal or intact EDM file and with the EDM file after using in the after using for shaping, there is absolutely a very less change in the morphology of the file. So even though the file has a lot of rough surfaces, it's not going to affect the mechanical properties of the file in a negative way. It's going to rather enhance the mechanical properties of the file. Next, now we are going to talk about gold files and blue files. Gold files are golden files and blue files are blue file, which is blue in color. These files are also controlled memory file. That means you pre-bend the file, you place it inside the file, inside the canal, the file will take or will remain in the same shape. And they are manufactured from some special thermomechanical treatment. The gold file and the blue file, they have different austenite finish temperature. Suppose the gold file has X austenite finish temperature, the blue file has Y austenite finish temperature. So there is a difference in the finish temperature of these files. When they are machined, they are surface treated, and before heat treatment, before final heat treatment, these files are grounded. This is the difference in the gold and blue file when you compare to your CM files. Okay, wave one gold and Vortex blue. Advantages are they have high fatigue resistance and really high flexibility. Now coming to max wire technology. Max wire means the file is in martensite, austenite, and this is electropolished file. Okay, so max wire technology is patent thermomechanical alloy treatment by FKG Dentair. In this file, there is a martensite phase and an austenite phase. Martensite phase exists at a temperature of less than 35 degrees. Above 35 degrees centigrade or at 35 degrees centigrade, the file is in austenite phase. So this is just the reverse. That means the file is very flexible when it is out of the canal. But when you put the file inside the canal, it becomes stiff. Okay, the file can bend in any direction. It is highly flexible. It is highly, it behaves like a spring when it is out of the canal. But when you place inside the canal, it takes its original shape. So this is the file. It's just the reverse. In martensitic phase or in normal condition, the file exists as straight file. Okay? But when it is placed inside the canal, it takes the body temperature and it turns back to its austenite phase. That means the original shape of the file is like a curved hook near the apex of the file. So you have XP endo shapers, XP finisher, and finisher arts. You can see this is the original morphology or original shape of the file. Okay. So XP endo shapers, the advantage is they are super elastic. The taper is absolutely 0%. They are quite flexible when inside the canal. At the same time, when they are inside the canal, they are in the form of a snake, serpentine shape instruments. And serpentine shape instruments create the wobbles or create different movements inside the or oscillations inside the canal, which helps in shaping. when it comes to endofinisher, these files, when placed inside the canal, they are very elastic, they are very flexible, because they take their own predetermined shape. Because of this shaping, they produce movements inside the canals which help in finishing the wall. So this is the principle of XP endofinishers and endoshapers. The advantages are they have high cyclic fatigue, they don't break easily, and they cause better canal preparations. But the torsional resistance is very, very low. That is why with endoshapers or with endofinishers, you should always prepare your canal first with minimum 20 or 25 number file. Then you should go with endoshapers. Now, coming to TY technology by Micromega. As we all know that the file is machined. It is machined to achieve a desirable cross section, to achieve a taper, helical angle, pitch length, and radial length, and so many morphological characteristics. The machine file is subjected to surface modifications. That means with TY technology, the file is subjected to electropolishing to remove the surface defects. After electropolishing, the file is subjected to a special heat treatment with different austenite finish and martensitic starting temperature. That patented thermal treatment by Micromega is known as TY technology. So you do machining, then electropolishing is done, and finally heat treatment or thermal treatment of the file is done. The files commonly available with TY technology are TS1 and TS2. Okay, and advantages of this particular technology is that it increases the torque resistance. This is in contrast to most of the files manufactured by different thermal treatment. You know, this particular type of thermal treatment also increases the torque resistance of the file, or the torsional failure of the file reduces. The cyclic fatigue of the file, resistance of the file increases. That means the life of the file increases. The flexibility of the file increases. Files become really flexible. And it also enhances the cutting efficiency. These are my favorite files, and I'm a big fan of TS1 and TS2. I use them routinely in my practice. Some of the cases done with these files. Coming to C-wire. C-wire is a patent by Micromega, and that was introduced in the year 2017. This also has a controlled memory. That means if the file is bended or pre-bended, it will take the same bended shape inside the canal. The file is one curve. It's a beautiful file system, just a single file system by Micromega. And it is highly flexible because of its special thermomechanical treatment. The canal centering ability is also high, which reduces the chances of iatrogenic errors like, zipping, ledging, or apical transportations. It has high cutting efficiency and fracture resistance. So it's a single smart file for multiple canals. This is a case which I did with C-wire technology file, one curve. So after going through all this, I would say, you imbibe these principles and try to incorporate these principles in your routine and your practice. Don't be judged by the dealers who come to you. Rather, you have to tell them which file system works best and you are comfortable with which wire technology. All right? So keep on updating yourself. Don't follow the principles of an old crow. Okay, update yourself. Because once you are updated, you can find so many reasons to enhance your work, to enhance the efficiency of your root canal procedures. Okay, thank you so much. This is my WhatsApp number. You can contact me on this. And next week, again, at 1 o'clock, we are going to read about reciprocation, rotation, transline motions, or motions of different files. And you can follow me on Facebook as well. Let's come to the questions. If you have any questions, You can also share the questions in the Facebook link.